I'm Helen Ferrey. Miami-Dade County Mayor Carlos Alvarez and Commissioner Natacha Seijas have been recalled. On Tuesday, 88% of Miami-Dade voters approved the measure to remove both politicians from office. Is this the beginning of political reform in Miami-Dade County or the establishment of a dangerous precedent in an era of hyper-politics? Maybe even both. Joining us to discuss this is Antonio Finns, editorial page editor at the Sun Sentinel. Michael Lewis, publisher and editor of Miami Today, and Tim Elfrink, staff writer at the Miami New Times. Thank you all for being here. Michael Lewis, let me start with you. You were originally against the recall for philosophical reasons,
yes.
And then you changed your editorial line and came out in favor. What was your thought process throughout the way?
The thought process initially was, I think recall should be reserved for malfeasance, moral turpitude, something more than being totally wrong on policy issues, which I thought the mayor was. I did not support him, but I thought that he shouldn't be recalled simply because he was on the wrong. I was on another side of an issue. But when he started using county employees to keep himself in office, that crossed the line. That was at minimum an ethical issue, maybe a legal issue, maybe not a legal issue. No one's probably going to check into it at this point. He's gone. But I thought that that was crossing the line. And at that point, there's no way I could defend anything he was doing, and he had to go.
Michael Lewis, I'll tell you that. I think a lot of people saw it your way. There's an analysis that was done by Ben Dixon and Amandi International after the election. And when you look at their original poll results, and we had Amandi, Fernand Amandi here, I believe it was, if not last week, 2 weeks ago, to talk about the poll, which he took March 2nd through 3rd, it showed that 67% were in favor of the recall, 15% undecided. The entire 15% went in favor of the recall.
And more.
And 6% from the no against the recall did what you did, turned around, and went in favor of the recall, so you had 88% in the end. My sense is because they saw what you saw.
There were other people who told me the same thing, that they had been against a recall because a recall had a higher barrier than simply an election. A recall is not an election. We've had an election. The mayor was elected. He should serve out his term unless he does something terribly wrong. Regardless, think of the president of the United States. At some point, the president's popularity falls below 50%. Do you try to get a president out of office at that point? No, you live with the president. In the same way, I think we live with a mayor whose judgment on baseball was atrocious, whose judgment of the community was atrocious, whose judgment of taxes was atrocious. Bad judgment, that's not the reason.
And yet, Tony Finns, yeah, this is the result. 88% said a resounding no. Mm-hmm. And many people are saying, now what?
Well, now what? I guess the next step is this simply a removal of two individuals that were very unpopular, or does it lead to a change in the structure of government? And I think you would hope that it be the latter. Something that's been talked about is some sort of measure that allows charter review commission ideas or recommendations to go straight to the ballot, as opposed to having to get the stamp of approval from the commission, which is, by the way, the way it works in Broward County. It's the commission that ultimately puts it on the agenda. I think that's a mistake, and I think there are a lot of people who have served on charter review commissions in both at the county level in Broward, but also in the city level, who felt that they came up with good ideas, they wanted the voters to weigh on them, never got a shot. And I think that's the one structural reform that is really needed across the board, not just in Miami-Dade, but also in the Great North where I'm at.
Do you see this recall the same way Michael Lewis does?
Yeah, I think that what I saw and what I heard when you read in the papers, the one quote from Alvarez that struck me, and when I could tell this guy, he would be in trouble, is there was one time where he said, I'm not going to do something symbolic. And that struck me as being incredibly tone deaf. Because the difference between doing something that is token, that's superficial, just for appearances, and something that's symbolic that says, look, what I'm going to do here really is symbolic. It's not really a major game changer, but it denotes that we're going to change course. That we've heard you. We got the message, and going forward, we're going to act differently. And when he came out and said, we won't even do that much, it struck me as someone who is really out of step with people. And that's one thing that we've seen also in Broward County is the pronouncements, that tone deafness is really what eats at people and eats at the popularity of some of the elected officials.
And Tony, you keep mentioning Broward County, and of course what's going on in Broward County is significant, and we need to really focus on another program about what's been going on and the arrest of so many public officials and so many investigations. Why has there been that deafness, that lack of connection to voters and the public, at least if nothing else, to have fear of the Lord, to try, for appearance's sake, to try to do the right thing?
Arrogance, in one word. It comes down to arrogance. There are certain things that have happened in Broward County that anyone who looks at it, regardless of what the legality is and what the legal standard is, there are things that have been done that just don't look right. They smell right, and they rub people wrong. You got most people out there working, and particularly in a tough economy, or not working in a tough economy, trying everything they do to make ends meet, and then you've got folks who are elected to office, who have been given the privilege to serve the public trust, and they're pulling fast ones, what people perceive to be as fast ones. That's what's, again, that's what eats, is that perception problem that really does eat at, it eats at the popularity more than even the being wrong on the public policy issue.
And Tim, I think that would be the same case that could be made here in Miami-Dade County. Yeah. There were so many issues, aside from some of the basic public policy issues that Michael Lewis highlights, just the issue of Mayor Alvarez wanting a third car paid on the county. And he's right, that car payment, that BMW wouldn't have made the difference really in the county budget. But the symbolism that Antonio Finz mentions, Tony talks about, is significant. But what do you need a third car for?
Well, that's why that was a great quote to mention, because, you know, the guy just didn't get it. He was doing things that were symbolic to voters all along, but they were symbolic of the fact that he didn't understand that the economy had tanked. He didn't understand that unemployment was at 12%. You know, the fact that he's getting new BMWs to drive, the fact that he's granting these huge raises to his personal staff and to police and firefighters, you know, the fact that he's okaying a property tax hike for, you know, a good number of homeowners in the county, you know, those are symbolic actions. Even if they had good underlying reasons, even if, you know, driving this car didn't actually cost taxpayers any more money than if he hadn't gotten a new BMW, you know, he was tone deaf to the fact that he was sending signals to voters that, you know, I really don't care that you lost your job. I don't really care that this economy is tanking. You know, we're going to keep doing business as usual. And we're not going to make any sacrifices of our own. And I think that was ultimately his undoing, you know, was that political tone deafness.
You know, you started, Helen, when he brought out the budget. And you remember what the first words of his budget were? I am proposing a no tax increase budget. That was his words. And he stuck to those words throughout. As we realize that it's more than 14% tax rate hike, he's saying there's a no tax increase budget. What he meant was the county was going to have no more taxes in its pocket than before. You're going to pay 14-15% more, but the county doesn't have it because those people who went out of business aren't paying taxes. Those people who don't have homes anymore aren't paying taxes. So you're going to pay a lot more taxes to make up for it. And he stuck to that all the way along, just as he stuck to the baseball stadium all the way along.
And
he
of
was
course,
reluctant to change.
And of course, technically, a rollback is not technically defined as a tax increase, but of course it is when you get your tax bill. And it's those half-truths, it's that smoke and mirrors stuff
all the way
that I think was really the final end. And of course, the architect to that was the county manager, George Burgess.
Yeah, and look, and I have to tell you, we've had that discussion. I think every municipality has a discussion about the rollback and are you paying more, the taxes down it. The fact of the matter is the average person gets that property tax bill and they look at what they paid last year and what they're going to pay this year. And if there's a difference that goes up.
When your property values are going down.
Well, even then, if the number you're going to pay is more than what you paid last year, it is a property tax increase. We can call it a rollback. We can play all the word games that the elected officials play. But the average person knows that their taxes have gone up. And not only their property taxes, if the fire fee goes up and the other assessment fee goes up.
True.
They, in their minds, they know my taxes went up, period.
And also, the mayor, when he was campaigning, certainly in Spanish language media, was telling the elderly that all services were going to be cut. And I think from what I hear from people who live in older communities, they were not happy. They were, first of all, afraid, and then they were angry that they were being played or felt they were being intimidated.
The voter is not as stupid as we give him, as politicians give him credit for.
As a politician, I never heard the mayor make a cogent case of where this money was going to go, what services would suffer if he hadn't done this. You know, those were never dots that I saw him connect in any way that a good politician would, to say that, look, you may not like what happened, but you're going to lose your trash pickup for a month out of the year if we didn't do this. You're going to lose police and fire service for you know, X number of days out of the week. You know, maybe there was some truth to that line of argument. I don't know the numbers in depth enough to say, but it just wasn't an argument that he made. I think it speaks again to his failings as a politician.
Well, and part of it too, again, people just aren't buying that anymore, because you're looking at most people down here either run a business or they have a connection to the idea that money comes in, money goes out, you got to balance your books. And when you throw out these scary scenarios, a lot of folks, they realize, look, in my business, I hear this all the time, I've had to cut my expenses, I've had to tighten my household budget. Mm-hmm. They got to do the same.
Columnist, just to support what you're saying, New York Times columnist David mm-hmm. Brooks mm-hmm. has spoken frequently about shared pain when it comes to budgetary processing. And when there is the sense of not an evenly shared pain, then you get precisely what you're talking about, that the businessman and woman is saying, or the employee or the person at home saying, we had to make sacrifices and we don't see how you can justify pay raises during this time.
We saw in government a sense of entitlement, a sense that we are entitled. We have to preserve government. We have to protect government jobs. We have to protect government people. And you taxpayers, we're entitled to that because we're in government and you're not. And that's what we saw. That was my column this past week, so I'm just stealing myself.
And perhaps if you felt government was doing a good job, if you could say, well, Jackson Memorial Hospital is being run well. Well, if you could say, we see that everything is working with the ultimate efficiency, maybe there would have been support. But I have a sense that there was a groundwork before, that there was a lot going on. Tim, you mentioned the issue of the Marlins Stadium being one of the big pieces, that once that began to unwind, and Michael Lewis probably did the most work. You're one of the ones who actually read every word on that 96-page contract. But that Marlins Stadium was really a critical turn.
Which is one small thing I might differ with you guys a little bit on. You know, there were, if I remember the numbers right, 70,000 absentee ballots that were cast, and another, you know, almost 30,000 early votes that were cast. And I think if you looked at the numbers, certainly afterwards, it would fall pretty close to the almost 90-10 split that we ended up seeing in the end. And those were, for the most part, cast long before this last misstep, you know, that Alvarez and Burgess made.
Right.
And to me, it goes back, the single biggest issue was this Marlins Stadium. I think people felt like the county executives really abandoned the taxpayer interest when they negotiated this thing, particularly, you know, if they didn't already feel it when this past summer, you know, confidential financial documents were leaked from the Marlins that showed, you know, in fact, they're not a team on the verge of bankruptcy that's about to flee town and that's, you know, barely hanging on to its franchise. You know, they're one of the most profitable teams in baseball. And the idea that, you know, a billionaire owner with a really profitable team is basically getting a free stadium from taxpayers, however you want to parse where this money is coming from. It's an outrage, and it's, you know, I understand why people would be outraged about this during this kind of a recession.
And when it comes back to you saying that you never heard the mayor really argue his point well, he could have said, I believe in the Marlins being so important to our community that I felt that it was important to give it away. No, but he didn't say, I will give it away.
No,
he said it was a good business deal.
And so
when you analyze the deal, that's Michael Lewis, when you concluded that paying nearly $3 billion for a stadium doesn't make sense.
And the way they financed it, we're not going to pay the bulk of it. Our kids and our grandkids, frankly, my grandchildren are going to be the ones who are going to pay for it, because 35 years out, we're going to get hit with payments that are phenomenally large, more than $100 million a year for 6 years consecutively to pay back those bonds on a stadium that the county is saying is a $300 and some odd million county investment, but you're paying that kind of money back.
Tony Finn's Natacha Seijas lost this recall. She survived one a few years back, but lost this one. Surprised?
No, not at all, because I think we were starting to see the same numbers and the same poll results and some of the same attitudes from her that we saw from Mayor Alvarez. But the interesting thing, I think, is to go back a second to the what we were just talking about, is this question of, do you recall somebody for bad behavior or real something that that really violates the public trust versus somebody who makes kind of a bad decision? And if, you know, the Marlins stadium is a big deal, you know, personally as a baseball fan living in Broward, I thank you all for paying for the new stadium for me. But, you know, we had a situation in Broward in the last election where the, not akin to a baseball stadium, it was a courthouse issue, which was very unpopular with people, but there's no question that we need a new courthouse in Broward County. And the guy who kind of led the charge was Ken Kuechel, a commissioner who was acting as ceremonial mayor that year. And one of the reasons he then loses his reelection bid in November is voter anger over this courthouse decision. But you know what? He made the right call. Now, you can argue that the Marlins stadium was not the right call, but in this case, he makes the right call, and he ended up losing for it. And that, so that's kind of a dangerous thing that, you know, voters don't always get it right, but I think they did in both these cases.
Elected officials have to make tough decisions. And because they're tough, sometimes they're going to be things that aren't popular with the public. I don't think we should have a plebiscite on how each decision is made in government. So to the extent that I may have disagreed terribly with the Marlins stadium and we gave away $3 billion, there were people felt the other way. Now I think it's a lot of people feel the same way.
And in the case of Natacha Seijas, it's interesting because I actually lived there before moving to Broward. I was one of her constituents for many years. And I could tell you that she was one of the most approachable and helpful people. And when I was living in Miami Lakes, we had a number of issues that came up, and she came out to help us. And I was really stunned now as an observer rather than a participant, watching a lot of the pronouncements that she was making, some of the comments she was making leading up to this recall vote that I thought was, well, you know, that's not the same Commissioner Seijas I remembered from my days in Miami Lakes. But
I was a little surprised by the results. You know, for one thing, she had become such a survivor over the years. You know, she sort of got this aura. You know, and I think this did sort of develop later, but of, you know, this almost like a dark sort of villainous character that couldn't be defeated, you know. And it's interesting that Vanessa Brito, who founded this group Miami Voice that led the recall, you know, she had approached Norman Braman beforehand to try to do this as part of the larger recall effort. And he basically said, you know, I don't want to mix the message here, and I don't want to risk that we're going to dilute this thing by going after other people. You know, so she did this on her own without any real big financial backing, you know, just a sort of 27-year-old activist. And it's it is remarkable when you look at it that, you know, they so roundly defeated this commissioner with, you know, more than a decade in office with, you know, so many, brushes in the past that she had survived, particularly when you look at the fact that Natacha spent, I think, over $200,000 on this. On this recall, you know, if you look at the number of votes she got, she spent almost $15,000 per vote that she got in this recall, which is incredible.
Tim mentions Norman Braman. He was absolutely critical. It's not easy to get a recall. The county commission made sure that recalls are very difficult to put together, and yet he did this one and he was successful.
Yes, he put his money where his mouth is, and he's done it. He's a couple times before he's taken on the establishment. It isn't the first time that he's done it. Tony reminds me of the original Joe Robbie effort to revalidate and rebuild the Orange Bowl is another thing that he's gotten involved in. It's good that public citizens do that. The other side of that coin, and the thing that I've worried about all along, is he may have the best motives in the world, but you may get a recall effort next year by somebody who doesn't have the best efforts in the world, saying either you all are going to vote for me, or you're going to do this project for me in the county commission and county government, or else there's going to be a recall.
Tim, you had an idea about that. About you were talking about that you wrote a column last year regarding this issue.
Yeah, you know, to me, I was personally reassured, you know, speaking to Norman before the recall, by the fact that he made it clear from the outset that this wasn't about a vendetta against Alvarez, which is another way I think the mayor misstepped by trying. That was sort of his idea, was to paint this as, well, this guy's just upset that he lost in court on Marlins Stadium, so now he's trying to go after me with this recall. I don't think voters bought that, in particular because Braman was very clear from the beginning that this wasn't about Alvarez, and that in his mind, this recall isn't going to be a success unless it leads to some pretty significant charter reform, which is, you know, really, I think what voters want, I think they've wanted that for a long time. So, you know, I think that remains to be seen if that part's going to work out.
So we have a few minutes left for charter reform. Let's talk a little bit of some of the charter reform, Michael Lewis, that's being thrown around.
Well, we've thrown around 1,000 ideas, and people have, and they're all pretty interesting ideas, and I haven't heard too many bad ones. The idea is to get a coherent, cohesive package of charter reforms that link together, that so that you have a sort of a structure of county government that's being looked at in a unified way, and you need a charter commission to do that. You can't just put one thing or another thing on the ballot. The way charter commissions have been done in the past is the county commission is required every 5 years to name a charter review commission. They can name it any way they want to, or they can get any way, but that has to be done every 5 years. They're not required to put anything that commission says onto the ballot, and indeed they have done very little of putting any of those things on the ballot, but they're required to do it every 5 years. That would be next year. They would be very smart to be sensitive to the public and say, we're going to do it early this year. There's no reason they can't do it early and say, let's name one now. And they'd also be very smart if they said, we're just going to name organizations that are going to name members of this, so we don't name the persons ourselves, and we won't serve on it ourselves, as several commissioners did last time around. We're going to let them do it, and then we're going to let them put it on the ballot. That could, I think, dissipate a lot of the problems that the commission is going to face in the future. We have to see how well they listened. We've talked about the mayor not listening. How well is the commission listening?
The commission, and that's one of the things that the mayor, Mayor Alvarez, would say, and he was absolutely right, Tony, that, you know, he would propose things, but it was the commission, right, the commission that actually approved things. One of the things the commission's going to have to make a decision on is, within the next 30 days, is whether to elect, call for a special election for a new mayor or make an appointment.
Might be smart to call for the election.
You think so?
Yeah, from Broward, some advice from Broward.
Okay,
call the election.
Yeah. Call the election.
Call the election.
Now the question is whether to call a special meeting. Right now, Commission President Joe Martinez is waiting till April 4th in order to have, which is the next regularly scheduled
election. I don't think he said that. I think he said it may be as late as April 4th, or we may do it earlier. People are
Do you think he should do it earlier?
I absolutely do think he should do it earlier, but he didn't say he wouldn't. He said it would be April 4th at the latest, not it will be April 4th.
Okay, so you think he should do it, call it earlier.
Yeah, I do.
Do you think he should call it early? Any sense?
I think in this case, look, we talked a little bit about, you know, symbolism and being tone deaf. To give the impression that you're dragging your feet or that you're not crazy about this or that you're trying to figure out what to do in the wake of such a large, you know, such a lopsided landslide, I think is kind of foolish.
There, you know, actually there are some arguments to be made for an appointment, actually, if you just look at it objectively.
Yeah.
I mean, you could save $4 or $5 million for the county. You could appoint someone non-political as sort of somebody to kind of hold over the government until the next election. That said, the commission's not going to do it. I mean, they just watched voters absolutely demolish.
And if you also look at
Alvarez and
Seijas, go ahead. I'm sorry, Tony.
No, I'm going to agree that there are lots of good reasons for doing making an appointment, but politically speaking, in this environment.
The question would be, do you think the commission has credibility at this point in time to be able to do that and not to have an upheaval?
No, I don't think so. I think the credibility is not there. If I could have a point of privilege, I've managed to trash the mayor pretty badly, as we all have here. I'd like to remember that he has one legacy, two legacies that we haven't talked about. One is he did throw the lobbyists out of County Hall. He may have different people in there, but he did throw the lobbyists out of the mayor's office, which was a good thing in this county that we needed to have done. The second legacy he has is he created a strong mayor structure. I'm not saying that's a good thing. I was never in favor of it. I'm still not in favor of it. But he's left two things in place that have changed the county from where it was before, and at least one of those is very positive, and some people view the other as positive as well.
I'm surprised you mentioned the lobbyist issue. It's seems to have grown in size more than ever before, and maybe they may not be congregating on the 29th floor, but they're really evident.
They're with the commission.
County Hall.
They're there with the commission, but they're no longer telling the mayor what to do. I mean, I don't think if he'd had lobbyists with him, he wouldn't have made the mistakes he made.
That's a good point.
Well, wouldn't have made those mistakes.
But I'll say this, to join the, at least giving the mayor his, well, the former mayor his due, that in fact he did throw the lobbyists out of the county hall. then he ought to run for re-election in Broward. He'll win on that play. He'll win.
What about you, Tim? Anything that you can think of positively? And I ask with all due respect, because 80% of those who were polled by the Ben-Dixon Amandi poll couldn't think of one positive thing Mayor Alvarez had done. I've never seen some of the poll numbers or election results like we've seen here. Some of the election results that very quickly include 98% of those in Sweetwater voted in favor of the recall. 93% of those in Hialeah voted in favor of the recall. Those are astounding numbers.
It is incredible. And, you know, it is sort of funny in a place like Miami that this finally happens to a mayor who really no one accuses of being corrupt. You know, I mean, he's not... I don't know anyone that thinks Alvarez was a dirty politician, you know. And this is a county that we've had, you know, so many bags of money under the table and politicians, you know, doing lines of coke in their office and who knows what else, you know. And this wasn't a guy that was like that. This was by all accounts, a clean politician who, in the end, just turned out to be incompetent. And I think that's really what it came down to is, you know, voters, in a sense, ended up being much less forgiving of incompetence than of corruption.
That's the way it is.
He was clean, but not a politician.
There you go. We're out of time. I'd like to thank all of our guests for joining us. We encourage you to share your thoughts. Please visit our website at wpbt2.org/issues and post your comments on today's program. Don't forget to tune in to another edition of Issues next Friday night at 7:30 p.m. and Sunday at 12:30 p.m. right here on WPBT2. I'm Helen Ferre. Thank you for watching.